Hey everyone, the name is Erik Thor. In this video I will talk about my journey into politics and into becoming an adult in a sense, and also my journey out of politics and what made me go and what made me leave. I remember I was 12 years old when I started taking my first stumbling steps into political activism. It started with working at the school newspaper and writing articles about student rights. I wrote about how students should have a bigger right to speak out about issues, to vote on school matters, and to decide over their own education. I felt in many ways suppressed by my teachers, in the sense that they thought they always tried to tell me what I should learn. They always tried to tell me when and how, and they always limited me and kept me down. And I remember I got no response for this at all, nothing changed, and I was bored. I was very bored with school. And it was this boredom that brought me into politics. Politics became this arena for personal self-expression, and I remember how well it connected to my extroverted feeling, in a sense, and that it gave me kind of a way to voice all my thoughts. I was far earlier than this interested in politics and philosophy and psychology. I was writing to myself, I had so many diaries, I wrote long-winded stories about fantasy, and I had so many thoughts and perspectives, and I wanted to discuss them with others, especially with adults, because I couldn't relate too well to any of my peers. I would go to meet my friends, my adult friends, friends of my parents to argue about things, but it wasn't enough to me. And politics changed that. Politics made it seem like suddenly I could speak out. And I know at that time I was a UFO at the meetings. I didn't get any friends there. I didn't feel connected to anyone there. I wrote a few political motions. I wrote motions to in which I argued that companies that use ads with female bodies that have been reprinted and changed or some way have to disclose this. They have to tell other people that the female bodies they show aren't real. And I noticed later on that this actually got vocal support in the Social Democratic platform, and that it actually got reenacted. It got enacted as a political opinion. So I got my first victory already when I was a young kid. And it took a long time before I got back there. I left when I was 13. I took a hiatus from it. For a while there, it felt more like I was pulled towards the natural sciences. I ended up exploring physics, and I ended up thinking I would be a physician or a writer or a novelist in some way or form. But when I turned 15, I still felt that tug of boredom and isolation and a little alienation, in a sense. I grew up on the internet, so I had a lot of friends through the internet. I had friends from all over the world who I could speak and talk to, but I still felt like it wasn't enough, that I needed to make something for myself in the real world. And politics became that. I ended up plunging myself into that, and I've never been the person to do things slowly or to do things half-assedly. I've always kind of jumped into things and just let it become me. And it became me. I became a politician. I became politics. Pure politics. If politics was a person, I would be that person. When I was 15 to 17, all I did was political activism, campaigning, and everything. School was always like a secondary priority to me. I did as much as I had to manage, but my core priority was always politics. I took so many breaks, I skipped classes only to get out there and to write motions and to think about the world and about the political state of the world. My primary issues, I remember, were environmentalism, sustainability, peace and nonviolence issues, and human rights. I remember that I was quite rebellious in politics. I was, in many ways, always working in opposition towards the party. I tended to become this person that would always put myself in the corner, the distance away from everyone else in the group, and I would always be this person that said, let's do this instead. And I always had a different idea from everyone else. I was starting up private projects and private organizations within the party because I wanted to build platforms for new ideas and to create new propositions. It was generally the average day-to-day politics bored me. The average political discussions about parties and platforms and strategies and meetings bored the crap out of me. What I wanted to do was just traditional, old-fashioned politics that mattered, politics that made a difference. I was more interested in visions, in long-distance changes, and global politics. I felt often strongly turned off against local politics and against simple-minded or short-sighted politics. I had always been this person who in class as well as at political meetups would pretty much ignore what everyone else said and ignore the lecturer and fell asleep in class, and then as soon as I found a chance to promote my own ideas, that's what I did. And in that sense, I was quite selfish, I was quite close-minded in a sense, because I was always so focused on what I wanted to do. And perhaps because of that, I don't think that I ever garnered a lot of support in politics. People found me inspiring to listen to, I think, and people found my passion really engaging. They found my ideas really interesting, but they did generally prefer... They noticed how I wasn't really open to dialogue or compromise or to anything like it, so I never really attracted any larger position in anything. So what I ended up doing was I ended up leaving the party because it stands on mass surveillance, recording people's phones and so on. And what I wanted to do was I wanted to kind of start my own thing. I ended up going into the Green Party at that time. It was just me. There was no established Green Party, local branch, youth branch. So I started up my own. And I got there and people said, you can be the chairman of it. And I was like, what? That my first day at the Green Party meeting, they all looked at me and they said, you can be the chairman. And I was like, okay, sure. And I remember thinking about it. You can think about how can an introvert ever survive in politics and in that climate, always people, always talking to people, always engaging others. How did I manage? And to be honest, I had two primary issues. I was so fucking nervous all the time. I was always so nervous. I was a wreck most of the time. But I never show this to anyone else. And my biggest issue has always been this. I think I finally understand my biggest issue. I've always had to put on this strong front to everyone else. I've always had to act tough and like everything was okay and I was happy and everything was perfect, even when it wasn't. I had to be strong for everyone else. I had to carry everyone else on my backs, and I tried too hard. And I put on so much stress on myself because of this. I feel like I was gradually breaking myself down with everything, with every meeting, with every action, with everything I did politically. I was continually breaking myself down and giving myself a hard time. I was shit-talking myself in my own head, calling myself an idiot, just speaking unkindly to myself. I kept hurting myself, pushing myself, telling myself to be better, to be stronger, to be more persuasive, to be think more, to work harder, to push myself harder, and I continually blame myself for not doing enough, or for not winning the political discussions, for not getting the debates through, for not supporting the people I felt I wanted to help. I have carried everyone's expectations on my back, and I really laid myself out there. I went on stage talking about what I cared about. I retreated into toilets whenever I had the chance to just handle my nerves and to keep myself in check. I had issues with my digestion system. It was like my stomach stopped functioning because I was under so much stress at that time. And I was so afraid of power in particular. I think my biggest issue was I was so afraid of power. I never wanted any power. I never dared to run for any mayor positions. I always worked as a back behind the scenes person. I never thought I'd be able to handle it, because I knew I was aware to some extent of how troubled I was and how broken to some extent I was. As all of this was happening, I felt broken. I felt like there was something wrong with me, like I had some issue. I kept thinking, I just have to be stronger, I just have to work harder, and it will all go away, and I'll be able to get past it somehow. My body just started responding stronger and stronger against me. Whenever I got home from political conventions, I just got this crippling depression. I couldn't get out of bed. I had no energy. I was just dead. And it was hard for my friends too, because they saw how passionate I was, and they saw how much I cared about what they did, but they also saw how it broke me down. And they also saw how hard I was against myself, and it only became worse. Seriously, it only became worse as I went into politics. As feminism became an issue, I definitely took things way too far. I ended up kind of feeling like, as a man, I took too much space, and I should shut myself down and let other people move forward. And I ended up trying to do that. I ended up stepping away from many major spokesperson positions and putting other people in the spotlight. But still, I couldn't help the passion I had, and I couldn't help that desire to speak out and to do something. It was hard for me to sit behind and let other people handle things, while I felt so responsible for doing something for the world and for making a difference. And I ended up pretty much, even though I wasn't a spokesperson, everyone thought I was, everyone called me anyways, and yeah, it didn't change anything. The only thing I could have done at that point was leave completely, and that's probably what I should have done. But instead I kept on taking on things and doing things. And at the meetings, I think everyone identified me as a passionate, fiery extrovert. I was talking to everyone. I was dancing around. I was always hanging out with everyone. At the same time, I felt like I was an asshole and I was a jerk and nobody liked me and I was an idiot and everything was just shit. And it was only about the ideas for me. It was the ideas that gave me the energy to do these things. Like, it was my beliefs, my thoughts, my perspectives that I wanted to get out there. And if I didn't have anything interesting to talk about, I got bored so easily with everyone. If somebody didn't have any good ideas, I didn't want to talk to them. If somebody didn't have interesting questions, I wouldn't feel like they existed to me. It was like, yeah, hey, it's so nice to meet you. And I pretty much left as soon as I could. And I had that issue. I was extremely socially inept and socially incompetent, in the sense that I remember I never said goodbye when I left meetings. I never said hello. I only came, talked about my ideas, discussed things with people, and then I left. Did my thing. I did what I thought was interesting, but as soon as I got bored, I pulled away. And I was in many ways known as pretty much, if there was one thing, one core strength everyone recognized in me, it was me as a catalyst, in a sense. I came to people with solutions. When everyone was discussing things, I left, I knew the problem, I thought about it, I distanced myself, I went into my mind palace, and then I figured it out. And then I came to people and said, this is what we do. And for a long time, this worked perfectly for me. But when I moved to Uppsala, that's changed. In Uppsala, the competition was much higher in Uppsala. In Luleå, in northern Sweden, where I grew up, I could do anything I wanted. Everyone let me do anything because I was the only person and they needed me. And that was the core truth of it. There was no replacement. But in traditional politics, it's a game. It's social intrigue. It's people talking in private rooms. It's handshakes. And I was never a part of that. I was never making any connections. I was never striking any deals. I was never compromising. I was never making any bargains. So I got cut off from everything. And I didn't realize this, and I didn't find out why. I came to meetings, I spoke about what I was passionate about, I spoke about my beliefs, and I thought that it was what I said that made a difference. But often it was already, everything was already fixed before I got there, everything was already agreed upon, everything was already set. People had talked privately about what they wanted to happen, and they made it happen. It was rigged, the game was rigged before I got there. And I was cut off from any political position of power or influence, and I was pretty much pushed into the corner. People wanted me as a campaigner, they wanted me to do things for them, they wanted me to execute their ideas because they loved my passion, but they didn't want my ideas. And because I didn't have the ideas and only the responsibilities, I didn't have the energy to do it, and my energy shrunk, and people were like, what's happening with this guy? Why is he underperforming? Why isn't he as passionate as he used to be? And after that point, that became pretty easy to get rid of. Eventually, at some point, I don't think I was valued there anymore, because it was the ideas that made me feel interesting to other people. It wasn't my people skills, it wasn't anything in the likes. If there was something I really think I did right when I was in politics, it was coaching other people. Throughout my entire time in politics, everything I did, I feel like, was so much about building other people up. And I do think I did manage to do that. I do think that a lot of people found themselves encouraged by me, that a lot of people managed to get into political positions through me, that a lot of people felt that I listened to them, that I supported them, that I, no matter what, that I was fiercely loyal to other people, and that I was always there to listen, to help out, and to promote, and to be your friend if you wanted me to. I remember I made people understand, in a sense. I made people understand why everybody was against them, why people liked them, what people didn't like. I ended up making people understand political issues from a philosophical standpoint. I ended up digging deeper into lots of issues regarding nonviolence, conflict, war, environmentalism, and the psychology behind politics. I also had one core issue, and that was, in many ways, that I hurt a lot of people. It's true, I did hurt a lot of people in politics. And most of the time, it wasn't on purpose. It never was on purpose. But it was in a sense of my obliviousness to other people. I was so caught up in my own world and in my own head and with my own big picture. Everything was my vision. And people, everyone else was just a distraction from it. And in that sense, I don't think I was a good friend to other people. I don't think I was a good boyfriend to my ex at that time. I don't think I was that nice. I never was a nice guy. That's an interesting thing about me. I was a helper. I always cooked for people. I always did things for people. I always gave favors to others. I always was always there when people needed me. But when it came to saying nice things, when it came to being there, when it came to being reliable, when it came to all those things, I don't think I was a good person at all. And I think anyone who can remember me from those times, from those days, I think they remember how reckless I was, how fiery I was, how passionate I was, how many ideas I had, how outspoken I was, how confident I appeared, how low and crushing my self-esteem was at the time, how I pretty much had everything, and how I pretty much was overwhelming to be around, because I pushed myself to the limits, I pushed myself to the end until I got a burnout. I had no energy anymore, I couldn't do anything anymore. And at that point, I just went fully antisocial. I had a few years after politics where I had no friends, I didn't hang out with anyone, I cut off all my connections, and I had no energy. And what were my lessons from all this? Because I can you remember both the good and the bad? I can remember the good as in how I got to see so much of the world. I got to learn so much. I got to make a difference. I ended up noticing how much power I had as a person because I ended up having so much political victory. I ended up making so many changes. I ended up making such an impact on the national debate. I ended up organizing so many things. I think most people who know me are surprised by how much I've done throughout my life already. At age 25, I've already done so much. And I've just... I can just say I'm happy to know both how much power I have and what my limits are already. I already know what my limits are. And that can help me because that means that I can be much more careful and that I can that I can do and make a big difference in the world. I do think that I can still make a big difference in the world. But I can also do it while taking better care of myself and while being a good, better person and a better friend to other people. I think people who know me today know that usually I'm there for them. I will listen to them. I will help them out if I can. And to me, I think that's the most important thing, to be a good person and to make a difference. That's what I want to do. As a kid, I set out my life goal. My life goal was to learn the truth about the world and to change how people saw the world for the better. Hopefully I can do that. Hopefully I can make the world a better place. Hopefully I can make amends for the mistakes I made in the past. Hopefully I can learn from what I've done. Hopefully I can change for the better. Hopefully I can continue to be a positive influence on other people. That's my life story. I hope you all enjoyed it. I hope this gives you a better view of me. And I hope that... it doesn't give you a bad view of me. Because I am who I am. Every one of us have our issues. I wanted to be transparent with you because that's a really hard thing for me to begin with. And I felt like I needed to do it for myself.